Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. Welcome to worship indoors and to the discovery of what will our new normal be. We don't know. Well, I'm glad to hear good reports from last week. Glad you all like Bernie Powell as much as I do. He's a great friend and colleague and brother in Christ. And glad that he could be blessed by you as well as you by him. A few announcements as we get going. Kids Club is back, and they're meeting outdoors today, I understand. And that will be a time for our youth to have a more summery kind of Christian education experience. Speaking of summery Christian education, we have Vacation Bible School coming up on August 9 to 13. It's 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. There will be various stations. We have this theme of the Rocky Railway, and we have a team already developing, but I know we need more people. So right now, Sarah Fuller is up in the balcony, probably doing evil things to how I look on cable, but and I just got that wrong, because her name isn't Sarah Fuller anymore, is it? Sarah Marcolina. She is us. Okay. So that's coming up. Now, this Saturday is a very important event, and that is the Celebrate America. You know, it's a sing-along. The slide talks about the songs, but it's very important also because we're gathering to pray about our country. And we're also gathering to have times to speak reminders to all who gather about what it is this country can be, you know, endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights. You know, that's, those are huge things, that we recognize a creator, and that we are, as John Adams said, the Constitution is designed to govern a religious and moral people. It is wholly unsuitable for any other kind. We need our foundation. There's breadth, but we need that foundation. So let's do that. Let's be there for that, 5 to 8 p.m. Invite people. When you go by the screen by the town hall that talks about it, you know, tell somebody, hey, did you notice that? Come be part of that. It's 5 to 8 p.m. on Saturday. Music, talk, opportunities to welcome and to host. And let's look for those. What's we got next? The 30-hour famine. Sarah, anything you want to add about that?
We've changed times a little bit so that way we actually end at the end of the relevant service.
Cool.
We're looking for people to possibly help with a
potluck dinner
that
afternoon, that evening. We'll
help celebrate the kids who are making the 30 hours without food.
They will
have water, of course, but no food.
Excellent. Let's do it. Let's support our youth. One of the best things we can do is encourage the rising generation. So let's be about that. Okay. At the end of VBS, I love the way this works out. Our VBS goes to Friday the 13th of August, and then on Saturday the 14th is scheduled the Family Fun Day, which will take place on the Town Hall Green, or lawn, whatever you want to call it. And it's an opportunity to supply families that may be having trouble preparing for school supplies. And so there's free knapsacks, day bags, whatever you want to call them, available. And these are the supplies that are still needed. And so if you can take care of those and help out with those, there's a bin in the fellowship hall. And that fellowship hall will also happen to be where you gather now for coffee hour, right? There we go. See how I did that? Yeah. But it's always important. It's something we haven't been able to do until last week. Let's get together. Let's care for each other, and let's support one another. Next, volunteers. We always need help with the tech. And you know, a lot of the tech we learn to do, the live streaming and much more, this continues because it's the pandemic helped us catch up with this rising generation that we're trying to include in our ministry and to encourage in a faithward direction. And so we need people who will be willing. You know, Frank can train. He's very good at that. And if you're willing to help make it happen, it's not something you have to do every week, but this could be maybe help run a computer that's up there or a camera or
or anything else that will help with the setup beforehand or afterward, we would love to have your assistance for that. Thank you for that. Okay. We still are looking for a treasurer on that. You can speak to Jay Webster, to Christine Walters, or to myself. Next. Dinner and movie coming up September 11th. So that's gearing up. We'll talk to Donna, see how we can help with that. And the prayer shawl ministry. I think we've all learned the value of the human touch and the caring and reminders of that we're not alone through all that we've been through. And the prayer shawl is a beautiful way, a tangible way of being reminded that someone is not alone, though they might feel alone. So thank you, Louise, for what you do with that. And let's be aware of those who could benefit from this. If you're watching us on live stream or any other means, we do hope that you will let us know you're there. And if you're on live stream with us now, just type in the comment section. Just say good morning or anything else you like. It's important that we be able to connect with you and help you not be facing anything you're going through alone. So we look forward to seeing your comments and connecting with you. And would you, all of us, let's be aware of those who, you know, sometimes attending a church can be a little intimidating. We now with technology, we have try before you buy. You know, you can look in and see. And so we want to encourage people, hey, have you caught us yet? So let's be doing that. Good. This is now our time to gather to worship God. We are in his presence. He is eager to meet with us, and our hearts need his presence. So let's tend ourselves to the worship of God as Ellie comes and leads us in our opening call to worship. Please stand.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Please join with me in the call to worship. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth."
So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created.
God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth."
As we sing the song, "You're Worthy of My Praise," we're talking to God, and it is an echo song. So I will sing, and then Jane will lead the echo. You can join Jane. And on the chorus, we're all together.
Thank you.
Thanks to everybody who uses our prayer concerns to get word to us about the different prayers that are out there. You know, it's a important time. And please use prayers at fcchanson.org also if you're not connected into the prayer chain that Jane runs. You know, so that's doing that. That'll help us with that. Just want to say, David, glad you're on the mend. Glad you're back with us. Let's pray. Lord, thank you that as your psalms say, you heal our diseases. Thank you that you entrust healing art to many for your mercy that extends upon all. Thank you for the privileges of some of the technologies and advances that we live among. But we recognize them as being good gifts that come from heaven, from the Father of all good. Lord, I thank you for all you have brought us through. We thank you that we stand at a different time now. We're aware of continuing threats and needs to still be vigilant, but so grateful that, in a very official sense, the pandemic is behind. Help us to be wise and bless those who work to complete the victory over it. But help us also, Lord, to remember that each day is a gift from you. That when we take things for granted, when we take blessings for granted, we get ourselves into trouble. So we honor you and thank you for the mercies and blessings we enjoy. And perhaps none so rich as those kind hearts, those dear folk who lighten our days for smiles and hugs and kindnesses that help each of us. And Lord, they are a whispered echo of the grace you would shine in our lives. We pray, Lord, asking for your light to shine through this congregation. We have this special opportunity with some public enthusiasm about our Celebrate America sing-along and prayer for our country. And we just ask, Lord, that your hand would be on that time. Pray, Lord, that we would take the task of praying seriously. That we would humble ourselves before you and seek your face. And Lord, that you would teach us to speak that word of faith whenever your spirit nudges and to look for those opportunities eagerly. And you teach us, for we don't know the time we have. Lord, we do ask your healing touch to continue on David, that it be upon Brian, and that you touch his heart and give him victory over behavior that's caused trouble. We ask your mercies, Lord, to be with Mary Lou's cousin, Lisa, and her husband, Joe, as they face some distressing results. We ask you to touch upon Charlene, upon Debbie Cauley. We thank you, Lord, that you are the one who brings comfort to those who mourn. And so for the friends and family of Diane Hardy and of Fred Maitland, would you visit them with your mercy and grace. Lord, for Michelle and Paul and Samantha, each on different journeys, would you hold them in safety as they travel? We ask, Lord, your blessing, your empowerment, your guidance upon our youth and family ministries, and especially upon Sarah, as she is our ministry leader now. Guide them, Lord, and help there to be effectiveness. And Lord, bring new faces and help us to be welcoming. For Coralie and Steve and others who seek new housing, we pray, Lord, and we pray for justice in the whole housing situation and in our court systems. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the heritage of where we live, for the beauty of where we live, but also pledge to you our faithfulness in the places you call us to. Help us, Lord, the family members that we can connect to, neighbors, friends. Let us live knowing we are called by you to be ambassadors of your ministry of reconciliation. And thank you that as we live as those grateful for your grace in our lives, your light shines through. Lead us, Lord, and help us. We honor you as the one who gives us hope and purpose and joy. And for all your blessings, we devote ourselves to you, and we pray as Christ taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God blesses, and he provides. He provides for each of us, and he allows us to respond to his mercies by giving back. You know, I think of Dave Ramsey, who said, if you think about it, that God gives you, every $100 God gives you, he just asks for 10 back. And every time you give the 10 back, you know, it's because he gave you 100. If you think about it in terms of he only asks for 10 back, you'd say, wow, can we keep playing this game? We keep getting all that in. The opportunity to free ourselves from the encumbrances of the world and to say, Lord, I know you are the source of goodness. That's why we give, we honor him, and we give so that we can, through these ministries, serve him. And if you're here, there's baskets in the back and folk I know mail in. And if you're online, you can simply go to the website of fcchanson.org and click on donate. And that will take care of that also. But whichever way you give, it's an act of worship. So let's dedicate our offering to God. Lord, we thank you that you do provide. And help us, Lord, to be caring for each other. But would you take the gifts that we give? Would you consecrate them to your purposes? And help all of us, every board, committee, and ministry, to be faithful and obedient in our use of funds. Help us to be obedient in our giving as well, and in our support of important ministries around this world. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together for our song of thanksgiving.
Our scripture reading this morning is from Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 through 18. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall die." Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner." This is the word of the Lord.
Reminded that it's been since the 6th of June since I preached here, because 2 weeks ago, and last week I was away, but 2 weeks ago we had a little pandemic-sized pulpit exchange, popularly known as the switcheroo, and I had the fun, really, of traveling up to Beverly and preaching to the Church of the Cove, a church in the Cove in Beverly, beautiful setting under a big oak or maple tree, I'm not sure which, but it was just looking and seeing folks who adapted some similar ways to us with outdoor worship, and also folk who are trying to say, okay, how do we serve God in these circumstances? And it was nice to be part of them, and I know they'd want to be remembered to you. Title of the message, Serving God in Your Daily Grind. Marie Hebert wrote a book called The Job from Hell. on-the-job survival aids, rather, for Christians. And this is from the introduction. As a reward for surviving another work week at my grueling job, I treated myself this morning to the breakfast buffet in town. The coffee here is too hot to drink when first poured. I stare comatose into the mug while waiting for it to cool, thinking to myself, people have no idea how much stress I work under every day at my job. Suddenly, my self-centered thoughts are interrupted by the raspy, unnecessarily loud, over-the-top greeting of my waitress. She rattles off the scripted checklist that all waitresses memorize. She wishes me good morning, tells me her name, and assures me that she would be taking care of me. Not once did she make eye contact with me. She was too overwhelmed with stacking and balancing her tray with the dirty dishes from someone else's table. Her job was to recite the script, not mean it. Time to actually care about her customers was not a luxury she was allowed. She was in hurry mode. She was denied the time, forbidden the interest, and drained of the physical energy needed to make any encounter with me a genuine one. She was simply exhausted. As she walked away from my table, I noticed a slight limp in her right step. I bet that hurt. I bet her boss rode her constantly to move faster, to keep up, or worse, to punch out if she couldn't do the job. And she was not the only waitress I noticed limping. Oh, God, I sighed under my breath. I have finally found a job that I would hate more than the one I have now. Work is a problem. People say, you know, some people say, find a job you love and you'll never work a day in your life. But how many of us, when we complained about our first real jobs to our parents, perhaps, heard, of course it's unpleasant, that's why they pay you. You know, if we only knew that our work mattered, that we weren't just company drones working on the company clock and going through the company script, then maybe we wouldn't be so depressed by our work. And what if you don't have a job? Maybe you take care of the family at home so someone else can bring home a paycheck.
Maybe you're busy at home caring for someone you love, prevented from doing what you would love to do. What if you can't find work? Or what if your body prevents you from doing what you'd like to do? Are all our efforts futile? Or can we really serve God in our daily grind? St. Paul, the key instrument of God in spreading the Christian gospel throughout the Roman Empire, loved the Christians who gathered to serve God in the city of Thessalonica. Because of his affection for them, he also wrote some gentle correctives. And listen as I read 1 Thessalonians 4, just verses 9 to 12. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me. Learned, received, heard, and seen in me. And the God of peace will be with you. I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at last you have revived your concern for me, but had no opportunity to show it. I'm not reading the right book. It's really good stuff, but I need a vacation. There we go. Now, you're saying, why can't he just read off the screen? Right. Concerning the love of brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anyone write to you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love one another. Indeed, you do love all the brothers and sisters throughout Macedonia, but we urge you, beloved, to do so more and more, to aspire to live quietly, to mind your own affairs, and to work with your hands as we directed you, so that you may behave properly toward outsiders and be dependent on no one. Now, Paul said there, live a quiet life. He was warning against flitting here and there, and said they were to stay at home, paying attention to their own responsibilities. Think of this as how it's been reworded by the great prophet Bill Belichick. Do your job. Some people might have a job that requires travel. That's not what he's saying against. He's saying, though, make sure you take care of your responsibilities. Because work is a major part of our lives, and because it can be difficult in so many different ways, I want to help us see from the scriptures how you can indeed serve God in your daily grind. The key thought for us to understand is that work was designed by God as our earthly occupation. Working well honors him and fulfills his purpose for him. It honors him and fulfills his purpose for us. Now, someone is mad at me already. If work is from God, then God is a sadist. But that's not true, because we know what God's will is from those first 11 chapters of Genesis, which established so many of the key principles of understanding and living out the purposes of God. In the Old Testament readings given for us, we're taught that work was given before sin entered the world. Before sin entered the world. So it's part of God's perfect creation. Work was already there. Another verse from Genesis reads, God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. He told us to work the garden he placed us in, and to have charge over it. And the root word there is to exercise great care over. This is part of the original plan. Work is given in Genesis 1 and 2. Something went wrong. Created with a free choice to sin or not sin, our first parents chose disobedience and reaped the consequences. This fall of the human race is described in Genesis 3, 17 to 19. And it includes God's sobering words to the man, because you disobeyed my command, cursed is the ground
because of you, through painful toil, you will eat of it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you. By the sweat of your brow, you will eat your fruit. So yes, there are problems with work, but God's original plan for it was good. Every time I do a wedding ceremony, I remind the congregation, our Lord Jesus Christ, by his own presence at the marriage feast at Cana in Galilee, hallowed and ordained marriage. Those words sound familiar, Mrs. Marcolino? I don't know. Okay. But the same thing can be said about work. Our Lord Jesus Christ, by his own labor as a carpenter for some 30 years, hallowed and ordained work. Carpentry, while humble work, is one of those jobs where you can enjoy the work because the wood doesn't talk back. You have to deal with customers, though. Michael Hoodman wrote, God created man, the human race, to enjoy work so that God could enjoy watching him, just as parents enjoy watching their children achieve a new skill or create an art project. Interesting perspective. Everyone who faithfully, honorably, and capably works at an honest job deserves respect. If you flip burgers as your work, do your best and pray as you go. Show kindness to those you can. We spend more time with the people we work with than probably our own families, many of us. Work was given as part of God's perfect creation. Work also fulfills each man and woman's need for purpose. I think you got to go forward there. Work also fulfills each man and woman's need for a purpose. Take something for this from the book of Ecclesiastes. There are some different theories out there, but my understanding is that Ecclesiastes is written by Solomon late in his life. He's known abundance and joy in obedience to God. He's fallen victim to temptation and seen how going his own way brought everything to ruin. And then by the time he writes Ecclesiastes, he's seen the error of his ways, and in his old age is writing to warn future generations against his worst mistakes. So when he said to God, you have put eternity in the hearts of men, or of mortals, eternity in the hearts of mortals, he was speaking a word of God-given wisdom, which recognized that being in the image of God, remember that Genesis reading, it means that we, like our Heavenly Father, are created for greater things than an earthbound life. Eternity in the hearts of mortals. God has planted in us a deep desire for our life's work to have significance, to have a purpose. Surrounded, kind of making the bread and the sandwich around the verse in Genesis that tells us that human life is created in the image of God, we find the function God has in mind for us. And then his commanding us to be fulfilling that command. We are to be responsible for the other living creatures. Some translations put it, have dominion over the creation. But that word, that verse of command is controversial because does it have dominion over mean it's a privilege to be exploited? Some cynics claim that the command for the human race to fill the earth, subdue it, rule over it, over the living creatures, is written by men in order to give themselves the illusion of divine authority to do whatever they wanted. To rape the land. They claim this is a source of animal cruelty and environmental destruction. But those cynics and the offenders need to read the parable of 10 talents. You know that parable? Jesus says the great king leaves on a long trip and he leaves his servants with treasures to take care of while he is gone. And while he's gone, some act like it's party time, while others seek to fulfill their master's command. And when the master unexpectedly returns, Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again, he deals with his servants according to the level of their obedience. And every one of us needs to see where we fit in that story. We're servants left with a job to do till our master returns. The earth and all that is in it belong to the Lord. He's made us stewards of it all. Yeah, it's not just flora, but also fauna. The garden had us in the midst of the animals. Excuse me. So taking care of the garden included taking care of wildlife. Much of the work that God gives us carries with it purpose and responsibility. Much of our work involves treating the raw materials we work with as trusts from God. Whatever it is you do, how you occupy your time, whether you draw a paycheck or not, you have an opportunity to show yourself in relation to God. So whether we're talking about lumber, silicon, the fibers from which fabric is made, or human beings, whatever it is we work with in our day, they're all part of God's workmanship. Now, on the other side, if you're making a living by cheating people or giving them a product that damages rather than helps, find a new job. God will honor your looking when you decide that you will no longer be prostituted. And the church will back you up. If we commit our working lives to God, we will discover God's fulfillment of our need for a purpose. Now, because God is so smart, he's also designed work to fulfill, to provide for our own needs, our family's basic needs, and also for us to help others who are unable to work. In that passage that I read the second time from the New Testament, the right one, Paul says gently what he says more baldly elsewhere as, "Let him who won't work not eat." When I was 16 years old, I did what I thought was a significant task around the house. And I told my father what I thought fair compensation would be. He hardly skipped a beat. He got a pad of paper and started doing some figuring, and when I asked what it was, which was my taking the bait, he said, "I'm just trying to figure out what you owe us for room and board for 16 years. I got quiet. You know, he died about a year later, but already he'd taught me to expect to have to work hard to get by. We said that work fulfills each man and woman's need for purpose. And that has nothing to do with a paycheck. There are still opportunities and responsibilities we each have. Someone who can't even move can still pray. Right now, my 85-year-old mother devotes a day every week to caring for a great-granddaughter whose mother has a medical issue that resembles chronic fatigue syndrome. What is asked of us may lighten as the golden years progress, but there's still a call on our lives. The Bible also teaches us that how we treat the weak, the sick, the elderly is how we love God. You've heard me mention how Mother Teresa saw in the face of every leper the face of Jesus in a very distressing disguise. And for 2,000 years, Christians have taken better care of their elderly than non-believers do, hands down. Jesus said, "By this will all people know that you are my disciples, that you love one another." Love cares. You might be spending hours caring for someone whose only response is to make life more difficult for you, whether intentionally or not. God sees. Your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Jesus died on behalf of a world that hated him. He understands, and he will work it for good in your life. Please remember that Paul had a trade. He was a tent maker. And that's a great portable job for someone who traveled throughout the empire. Those tents were heavy-duty residences and were always in demand. It was a great trade. You know, Paul was also the one who wrote that pastors and teachers are worthy of support from the people they teach among. And in the verse after that, he gave the not-so-flattering parallel that you don't muzzle the ox while he is treading out the grain. But Paul knew that examples teach better than admonishments. By his own example, he provided a teaching point for the early church, not to confuse spirituality with laziness. Among those who walk the Jesus way, there are no lagabouts allowed. So work is part of God's perfect creation. It fulfills each man and woman's need for purpose, and it's designed by God to provide for our own basic needs to help others who are unable to work. And someone is saying, but Peter, have you seen my job? It's hardly glorious. And I get that. And our opening story about that limping waitress tells that. You know, I think summer jobs are those things that you had to do that teach us what you don't want to do the rest of your life. Clean sewers, tarred roofs. I've also washed cows, but that was a bit of a lark. So, yeah, and I've had miserable, unreasonable bosses. What are we supposed to do with that? To understand why jobs can be awful, start by understanding that the corruption of work is a result of the fall that was described earlier. It's a consequence of disobedience. But with his victory on the cross, Jesus has overcome that. Some of the victory we don't see till heaven, but some of it we see now. And we can realize substantial parts of that restoration and reclamation of work. First of all, by getting right with God. You know, there is a distortion of our foreparents' ideal for our country that says you don't ask anybody for help about anything, not even God. I don't know how many here follow NASCAR or not, but Kyle Busch is one of the most successful drivers in NASCAR. And I think about if you broke your leg and you needed to get to the hospital, and Kyle Busch drove up in an ambulance and offered to take you to the hospital for free, would you say, nah, I'll walk? We are broken, and the expert wants to help. When we put ourselves in God's hands, when we ask forgiveness for our willful disobedience, when we promise to follow his guidance, we find a whole lot of things getting better, including our work and our attitude toward it. I'm sort of describing signing the deed of our lives over to God. He's the only rightful owner. He's the only one who knows how to properly care for our lives. And when we do that, there's usually a new outlook to our life. The colors of creation aren't black and white anymore. We can see more of God's purpose. New believers have joy in their hearts, but then they show up for work on Monday and see that their boss didn't get the memo. So what difference can a relationship with God make when we have really disagreeable work? A couple of ideas. First, bring God into your day. If your work is repetitive, Memorize scripture and run it over in your mind as you work. Pray for your friends, your colleagues, your loved ones, for people in responsibility. Bring God into your day. And then honor God by doing your best. If you work in a potato chip factory, make the best chips you can. Sweep the floor with diligence. And then third, pray for an opening for the gospel, for the people who are those you work with. You might need to gain yourself a hearing by proving yourself valuable. But be patient and ask the Holy Spirit to guide you. You know, we spend a lot of time with the people we work with. And there are people we encounter with, if we don't have that kind of a paycheck job, there are still regular people in our lives that we can make an impact on. Cultivate that. And let's be honest, some jobs are meant to be left. Maybe you need a change of work. How do you find what God has in mind for you? What is God calling you to? Martin Luther once said, in his usual over-the-top way, "You can be a hangman to the glory of God." Now, political issues aside, what he's saying is any moral job, no matter how unlovely, can be done to the honor of God. God has a calling, a vocation for all of us. And Frederick Buechner has the best quote on it, and it's in the chalkboard scribbled there. Your vocation in life, God's call, comes from where your great joy meets the world's great need. God's got a place for you, and he's made you so that it fits right. So between your experiences, your spiritual gifts, and your opportunities, God intends to make the world a better place. You're searching, if you got a friend who knows you well, who knows the Lord, or even better, a small group, they can help you discern God's will, your experiences, your spiritual gifts, your opportunities. In Minnesota, I was part of a small group with an employment counselor named Charles Yu. I was surprised to find his picture online, but I found it. And he had three questions that help believers know what to do with Buechner's definition of vocation. Your great need, your great joy, the world's great need. First, he said, what do you most love to do? Where is your joy? And with whom do you most love to do it? Among whom, who would be the recipients, but also who would be the co-workers? And then, what are the steps that take you from where you are to where you need to be? Take you there from where you are. You know, just before I left for vacation, we had the privilege, the sadness, but the distinctive opportunity to lay to rest and celebrate the life of David LaFord. And David LaFord was as excellent a craftsman as we might ever find. I was reminded that the balcony and its balustrades and such were, the banister and balustrades of the balcony, there, I got it right, were done by him, by hand, that he was sought out as perhaps the best carpenter of 18th century reproductions of 18th century furniture. But in addition, he was a fly fisherman, a tennis pro, and many other things. Just a remarkable, remarkable man. But he did excellence as a way of honoring God. I was thinking about a man I knew in Waterbury who was the YMCA custodian and a pastor in his church. And he would do all the tasks. His name is Alan Paris. He would do all the tasks of being a custodian, but at the same time cultivate relationships with the guys in the locker room and using those opportunities to serve God. And I was thinking of Elaine Zerolo, a friend of ours, who worked as a bookkeeper for a home improvement company, and she showed her value to everyone there. It wasn't her first training, but she sensed a call to that situation. She did her work well, with diligence. but it got her opportunities to speak words of life and hope into the people she worked with. You know, you can make a beautiful weld on a tailpipe to the glory of God. You can change soiled seats to the glory of God. You recognize that the one who washed feet and hung on a cross to pay for our sin receives your humble gift as an offering to him. Whatever the call is on your life, your responsibilities, enjoy his pleasure in you as you do it. Enjoy his pleasure in you. Work was designed by God as our earthly occupation. Working well honors him and fulfills his purpose for us. Let's pray. Thank you, Savior, that ours is not a Sunday-only religion, but that you have promised you will never leave us, that you will be with us always, every day, each hour. And so help us, Lord, to bring you with us to our responsibilities of the week. Whether they be in school, at a workplace, in our communities, in our homes. And to know that you care about those things that fill our lives. And so help us to be obedient in them. I pray, Lord, you would give peace and assurance to those who struggle, that you'd give guidance to those who recognize a need for change, and that you would help us to take seriously our call to be encouragers to each other, so that this community might be a beachhead of life as you intend it to be, against the alienation, the loneliness, the disaffection that has taken root in too many places around us. Shine your light, your hope, and your joy through us. To the honor of Christ, we pray. Amen. Closing hymn is number 52, I Sing the Mighty Power of God.
Oh.
Lord, would you send us into this world, equipped by the grace and power of your Spirit, to share your light, your love, and joy, assured of your presence, of your help, and your strength. And all glory and praise to the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you.